So, what I would like to now do is introduce our final keynote speaker of the day, and that is Dr. Marcus Amann. He's the scientist for the Asia Pacific Clean Air Partnership Science Panel and former program director at the International Institute for Applied Systems Analysis. Dr. Amann will focus on bringing science and policy in tackling air pollution, lessons learned from Europe and Asia. It's an honor to invite Dr. Amann to speak. So, Dr. Amann, the floor is yours.
Thank you. Thank you. It is a great honor for me to talk at the 20th anniversary of IANET. And let me take the opportunity here to congratulate to all who have helped to develop IANET into an important institution for air quality management in Asia. I think after these 20 years, it's a good time to look back. And as Professor Akimoto has just pointed out, we see on one side the unprecedented economic growth both in Europe and Asia. And maybe you can illustrate this on the slide. If you can show the slide. The next one. And this graph shows the red lines is the increase of the growth of economic development, also the GDP. And we know that for a long time, emissions from economic activities have followed the same trend line. But remarkably, this trend has departed in the last 20 years. First in Europe, but also in the last 20 years, actually, very importantly in Asia, which had a very steep increase before. And I would strongly argue that it is not a coincidence that the trend reversal of the SO2 emissions in Asia emerged shortly, only shortly after the foundation of IANET, which focused specifically on SO2 and originally on acid deposition and originally on the SO2 emissions. And once the science has pointed out that also NOx is an important source of acidification, also, NOx emissions, the yellow line, have declined a little bit later. PM is still to come, and I think we have there important lessons to learn from these declines in SOx and NOx for resolving and giving input to the solution of the PM air quality problem. So I think it is safe to say that policy action, which led and which caused the trend reversal of emissions, came after science has pointed out the sources of the pollution problem. So science had a very important role to play here. And I think we also should emphasize today here that IANET was very instrumental in changing the thinking about how to tackle air pollution problems in Asia by emphasizing the importance of long-range transport. This is a very important lesson also for PM, which is still a problem, because PM, and especially PM2.5, have very similar long-range transport characteristics, especially the secondary PMs. And here we are talking about even the same precursor emissions, sulfur, NOx, ammonia, as has been pointed out by Professor Akimoto a minute ago. If you can switch to the next slide, please. In Europe, after this resolution of the acid rain problem, attention, air quality management attention turned to PM. And I think Europe has learned a lot from the features of acidification, how to tackle acidification, and applied this to the PM problem. This is an emblematic graph showing the source attribution, source allocation of PM2.5 in European cities. Here I show the example for the Netherlands, and it shows from the left to the right a certain fraction of natural sources which cannot be influenced. And then very importantly, the large bar shows the contribution of PM2.5, which is transported into the European cities, but originates in other countries. And on top of this inflow, there is pollution, PM sitting, which is caused by emissions from outside the cities, and then from the rest of the city, and then on the top from the street canyons from very close nearby sources. And only after this has been pointed out by science in Europe, that the long-range transport is so important also for PM, not only for acidification. Europe entered a rather successful path on reducing also PM2.5. In the past, all policy focused on the very local sources, because the understanding was also PM is a very local problem caused by traffic. So there was a lot of money spent on reducing emissions from transportation. But it was completely overlooked that the majority of the contribution comes from more distant sources. This is a very important graph because it changed the thinking, and it's also important because it helped to convey scientific insights in an understandable way to the public and then finally also to policymakers. And this changed, and originally in the time of acid rain, such graphs, this importance of the long-range transport triggered originally a blame game by pushing responsibilities for pollution to the neighbors and to the others, and was used as an excuse for not taking action. However, in Europe, we have learned that blaming does not resolve the problem. Also economically, it's a rather ineffective way forward, and a much better way, more efficient way forward is to start regional cooperation. And also there, science has provided very important insights which help to frame a collaborative framework for cooperation, which is then tackling the PM problem. The next slide, this slide is an illustration that this cooperation, that basically the physics and chemistry is similar. I mean, in principle, it's the same. Conditions are a little bit different, but in principle, it's the same throughout the world. And the superior benefits and the need for cooperation, for regional cooperation, also applies to other regions. And this is illustrated in this slide, which is coming out as now is a flagship report for the World Bank for South Asia, which shows the economic, the World Bank looks at economic dimensions, the economic benefits, cost savings from a traditional approach compared to a cooperative approach. And what you see on this graph is on the x-axis is the population exposure in South Asia, the current situation, the situation in 2030 with once the current policies will be implemented. This is this blue or dark blue area, the dot. And then the red dot indicates what the traditional business as usual policies where countries and cities, especially cities, take action independently from each other, uncoordinated. Yes, this will lead to certain improvement, but of course on the y-axis you see the costs that it requires additional resources. And in contrast with scientific tools, bringing together information on atmospheric science, on health impacts, on economics, one can identify solutions which deliver much larger health and air quality benefits at much lower cost compared to the conventional approach through cooperation. And that's a very important feature which convinced European policymakers for entering cooperative agreements. But as the World Bank was trying here for South Asia, the same potential exists in other parts here in South Asia, but certainly also in East Asia and other parts of the world. A critical element in this is how to how the scientific information which is required for developing the cooperative solutions, how this can be communicated to the decision making. And this is illustrated in the next slide. That's a rather busy slide. Originally it was animated, but I think here everything is on one plot. So let me start with explaining that in principle, effective decision making needs to integrate across information which comes out from different scientific disciplines. So one lesson is that the single scientific disciplines, for example, atmospheric science, is not sufficient to tell, to derive without additional information, what is the best way forward. So we need solid information on emissions. This is still on the lower part, the left column. Then on technologies and costs for reducing emissions. We need a solid understanding of atmospheric modeling, of atmospheric dispersion. And we need to understand what are the benefits, health impacts, and the benefits and ecosystems benefits from clean air. In Europe, an infrastructure has been developed, and we call them task forces. There are task forces which bring together scientists in each of these areas on a regular basis. So there are annual meetings of scientists of all the countries to share latest information, present latest information, criticize latest their latest findings, and synthesize the scientific findings in the various fields on the emissions, on technology, on atmospheric dispersion, and on impacts. And a striking feature is that we have these groups which bring together scientists from all the countries, but at the same time also experts, like experts from ministries, from stakeholders, and they are discussing and criticizing each other. But at the end of the day, they are developing a consensus input which can then be used for decision making. So finally, what is then used for decision making is not further disputed on a scientific basis. All this information is flowing then into a kind of an integrated assessment mechanism, which is, in practice, a common tool, a modeling tool, which combines this information. This is the GAINS model, which is, there is a special center, scientific center for excellence, which was established at YASA, at the Institute for Applied Systems Analysis, and I was heading this. And this center was bringing together this information, putting this together, and exploring the consequences on effective policy options which come out from this information. Of course, this is a scientific effort. These scientists cannot recommend the only way forward, but it can offer alternative options for possible and effective ways forward. The outcomes of this center were then regularly, annually reviewed by an expert group, a task force, which again was composed from national experts and from representative of the stakeholders. And only after review of this expert group, information was then fed into the policy level on the negotiations. And this structure evolved over the last 20 or 30 years in Europe and has emerged as a very effective mechanism, a systematic institutional mechanism, on the one hand to bring scientific information together, but also to distill the relevant information for decision making and feed this in a structured way to decision making, so that decision making is not diluted by the divergence of the variety of scientific aspects, but supported by systematic key and distilled information. And I think that's a very important mechanism. This is still a step to come in Asia, but it has helped a lot to make science speaking with one voice and distilling the critical features which are important for making good policy decisions. So let me summarize the key points I want to make today. And this is the next slide, please. So first, science provided, both in Europe and in Asia, science provided essential information for air quality management. It is important to identify the sources. Without this, policy tends to tackle waste money by tackling ineffective sources, the wrong sources. It highlights the importance of regional cooperation. It provides information to develop cost-effective cooperative solutions. And also very importantly, it can highlight, and this is critical, to the benefits to all the actors. So I mean, there must be a motivation for entering cooperative agreements. And essentially what we have learned is countries only cooperate or participate in a solution if they see benefits for themselves. And for this, science need to have a wide perspective on revealing the wide range of benefits so that all the actors see some beneficial aspects. And the second point from my last slide, I want to emphasize here that feeding the scientific insights into decision-making cannot happen on an ad hoc basis, then this leads to confusion at the science, at the decision-making level. But institutional science policy interfaces, there are examples which have worked well, and this might be also one dimension where, at least from the scientific side, IRNET could elaborate and evolve into the future. Thank you very much.